Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome Mr. Robert Stein.
Okay, good morning, everybody. It's nice to see you all. It's a great room. Thanks to the Chemical Heritage Foundation for having us this morning. Thanks to all of you for coming and being here. And thanks, Tiffany, for such a kind introduction. I'm going to wait for my slideshow to come up over here, but as we get started, let me tell you a little bit about myself and where I come from. As Tiffany mentioned this morning, I am the Executive Vice President, Chief Program Officer at AAM, the American Alliance of Museums. And I've been in that post for about 6 months now, and coming to it from other positions in museums, most recently at the Dallas Museum of Art and the Indianapolis Museum of Art before that. So I haven't always been a museum geek. I think we were talking this morning at our table here that we were museum geeks. Actually, when I was a boy and right up till I went to college, I was pretty convinced I wanted to be an astronaut. So I went to school to study aerospace engineering. And I got into that, and it was interesting, but it was right around the time that the internet was being born, and I happened to be in a place, the University of Illinois, which was the center of where that was happening. And that you know, explosion of innovation and, you know, just interesting things really caught my attention, so I switched. And I got into computers and technology, and as Tiffany said, that's sort of been a lot of my background. When I graduated with my degree, my first job was really working with scientists to help them explain some of the science that they were studying. So we did modeling and simulation. We would work with hurricanes and supernovas and tornadoes. So we would create computer models to really study what was going on. And then my job was to try to communicate that science to the public in some way. This afforded me, you know, a lot of opportunities to talk to people about lots of different kinds of subjects. And we worked in the public and with many museums, and that's really when I got hooked on museums. In fact, I did some work with the Indianapolis Museum of Art, and, you know, I want to be an astronaut, I'm a science guy, I'm a computer guy, but I just got hooked on museums and on art museums in particular. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about what I know. I recognize that not everyone here is currently working with a museum. Many of you are connected to cultural heritage in some way. All of you have an interest in visitors, and I'm assuming in connecting with those visitors about things that are meaningful, right? So that's actually what we're going to talk about today. I'm going to share with you about some of my experiences in Indianapolis, in Dallas, and now at the American Alliance of Museums. And particularly, I'm going to focus on what it was that caught my attention about museums. And this was a great opportunity to prepare for this talk, because it gave me a chance to really think more deeply about what was it that really captured me so much. This talk is a bit different than what I would normally talk about. We're going to touch very lightly on data, but today we're going to talk much more about people, and I'm grateful that the conference theme is about creating a culture of collaboration. And my work in museums has really been connected to that. I think one of the things that was so appealing is that it was very easy to sit in a room like this and strike up friendships with folks from around the world who had similar interests, and there were no barriers for connecting or collaborating with institutions even across the street, let alone across the globe. So that's very different than most other industries, right? You're not going to find many careers or professions where there is no incentive for, you know, proprietary information. You're a cultural organization, right? If you create culture lovers, you're helping the institution across the street as much as when they succeed in creating culture lovers, they're helping you, right? So as I got to think more and more about that, I really, and it may sound cheesy, but I really do think that museums can change the world. And I remember having this conversation in Indianapolis, as I had a very small team there. It was just two or three of us. And you know, we were sitting around talking about what we really wanted to get after, and what we decided we would try to do is that if we were going to work in museums, we really wanted to try to see if museums could change the world. And then the important question was, exactly how do you do that? And so I think I've spent the better part of the last decade thinking about not just how I can make our own museum successful, but how in doing what we need to in Indianapolis, in Dallas, and in DC, how can we succeed and at the same time help other people to succeed? And in thinking about that, it strikes me that in many ways, the museum, your organization, and the field works kind of like a body does, right? And the title of the talk is really thinking about a body in balance, or what does an ecology of museums, in my case, or cultural history, or your organization, what does that look like? If you think about the body has many different kinds of systems, and if any one of those systems is broken down or not working very well, then you can't really work as effectively, right? You'll feel it. You're off balance. You're off kilter. You're not effective. If my voice was raspy, I wouldn't be able to talk to you well this morning. If my leg was hurting, I'd have a hard time walking back to get my back. You know, it's the body needs to be in balance in order to work effectively. Some of you are in natural history organizations, and you teach about science and the environment, or your garden is working on the environment in your local area. So in many ways, the museum is like an ecosystem, right? Many separate pieces that need to work all together in order to have a healthy ecosystem, a healthy museum. And so if you look at just the definition of what an ecosystem is, and then think about your organization, a community of interacting organisms and their physical environment. This is really what we're talking about. The museum is not the building. Despite all of the great buildings that we see springing up all over the world, we invest hundreds of millions of dollars with them, but if you don't fill them with people who are working together, then they're just an empty shell and a beautiful architecture, but they, at the end of the day, mean very little, right? It's the people that fill the building that cause it to mean something. And if those people are working together well, then the organization can succeed well. And that's something that in pushing the envelope about how do museums change the world, I've bumped into multiple times with varying levels of success. The times that we're most successful is the times when we're actually collaborating and in most balance with each other. If you think about it, you often see diagrams like this, right, where the ecosystem works together by exchanging energy from the sun to the plants for photosynthesis. The plants are eaten by animals to get energy. Animals eat other animals, and respiration happens, and we're exchanging material things. In the museum, we're exchanging both material things and ideas. We're exchanging ideas here this morning that if I do a decent job of communicating, I hope you'll take them with you and exchange them in your organization at home. If I don't do a good job of that, then this system is broken and out of balance. So I'm picking on the University of Michigan Museum of Art, not because I know anything about them, but because they posted their org chart online. And if you think about this, right, we make charts like this about our own organizations. Maybe they're org charts, maybe they're workflows, maybe they're your visitor journey, maybe they're the content map of your website. But in this is very much the same thing, right? Different parts of this organization have to exchange ideas and materials. Sometimes they consume one another in ways that we might not be happy about. But organizations are like this. Organizations are systems, and those systems are made of people. When they're in balance, they're beautiful. But what happens when they're out of balance? And I think, you know, any of us that work on the edges, we're going to push into places in which we become out of balance. We're either out of balance personally, we're out of balance with our colleagues, or sometimes the whole organization is out of balance. And when that happens, I'm not sure if And many of you are familiar with this case of the Tacoma Narrows Bridge. It's really famous, right? You've seen this before. And what's happening here is the wind is whistling through this canyon and it's hitting the bridge at a certain frequency, and that frequency just happens to match with the harmonic frequency of the bridge. Put the science aside for a little bit. What the wind is doing is it's accentuating a weakness in the bridge, right? And it's persisting, and the bridge is persistently out of balance. And I don't know if any of you feel this way sometimes. I sure feel this way sometimes, right? I'm in a situation, I know I'm out of balance, and the wind is pushing on me, and that oscillation just continues, right? If you allow it to persist, we let this video play. Oh, there it is, the crash. We let this video play long enough, you'll watch that the bridge blows itself apart. We all are following honeybees, right? This is exactly the case of an ecosystem, and drawing that analogy a little bit further. Our honeybee colonies are declining and disappearing. And you ask, what happens? What happens if all the honeybees are gone? Well, the honeybees fertilize and pollinate flowers, and flowers turn into fruits, and fruits turn into food, and food is what our society needs to keep working in many ways. A lot of the scientists will tell us that if honeybees disappeared, up to 70% of the world's food source would disappear with them. That would put us into some significant imbalance. So in thinking about museums and about how we can change the world, museums as an ecosystem, it's chasing that balance that is what really stood out to me is what we should talk about this morning. You're going to spend the rest of the day hearing great presentations about how we can collaborate better together across institutions and with the public. And what I want to have you keep in the back of your mind is that as we do this, your organization is where that change needs to start. We're all familiar with this quote by Gandhi, and it stood out to me as I was thinking about, well, how do museums actually change the world? And in reality, we have to start with that change ourselves. I had the privilege of attending a seminar in Salzburg, Austria, with many people in cultural industries from around the world. It was on museums in the age of participatory culture. And one of our colleagues there shared with us of what was, I think, a Persian proverb, that the shadow is always darkest beneath the lamp. Has anyone ever heard that before? Raise your hand. Okay, only a few people. I hadn't heard it, but it makes a lot of sense, right? So if you're the museum that's holding out as an example of what culture can do in your city, how people can feel welcomed in your museum and how that can change our communities, what we have to watch out for or be very careful about is that we're paying attention to our own home place first, right? Are we actually walking the talk, or are we just talking? And so this has stood out to me and it's come back to me many, many times, that we have to be careful as we sort of attempt to shine this light out into our communities about what it means to work together and to collaborate, that the shadow is not darkest beneath our own lamp. And so we're going to look at that a little bit more. And the main point and the main takeaway this morning is that if we want museums to change the world, then we have to start by changing museums first. Okay? If we can't, then we're hypocrites. And really what that comes down to is that the museum is built on people. So what we were saying before, your museum is not your building, it's not your endowment, it's not your budget. You look at museums around the world, some of the most successful museums, both in the United States and globally, are museums that have only very few staff, sometimes no staff, and only very little budget, sometimes no budget at all. Yet they are sometimes the most successful in actually reaching and serving their community in a real way. So let's think about what that is. Museums don't change the world ultimately. People are the ones who change the world, right? The museum provides a platform and a lever for us to do that, but the people inside of museums, you in this room here, are the ones that can actually make that change happen. So I want to tell you some stories, and as I was putting this together, it felt a little like a family photo album, but I want you, so I'm talking about this, think about your own team, your own family at your organization. And I'm telling you some stories about some of my family. And Let's see if I can, oh, I guess this mouse is over here. Well, this is my team in Indianapolis, the team that we first had the conversation about, you know, maybe we could change the world. The gentleman at the lower right is Charlie, and the upper right is Matt, and we had that conversation together. Yvel is on the upper left in the red shirt. Yvel's from Haiti. He was an orphan in Haiti, was adopted in the U.S., came here, studied technology, and is the best IT director in museums that I know of today. He works at the Children's Museum of Indianapolis. Next to him is Ed Bakta. Ed worked with me in academia to communicate science. So Ed and I were working on hurricane visualization together. And Ed joined me at the museum because he thought that museums could change the world too. And he was a great lover of art and culture. Terry was a farmer who became an IT guy. Isn't that how it works, right? Daniel formed a team in the upper left that he called the Nugget Factory. They were responsible for creating all the media and stories. They called themselves the Nugget Factory because they saw their job as pulling the great golden nuggets out of the story that you were telling them and then making that as something that we could tell to other people. The funny thing about their group is they were all named Dan, except for Despy. So it was Dan, and Despy. So they all had names that started with D, which was a problem when their intern Emily started. They said, well, you have to pick a name that starts with D. So she was Demily for a little while. But Emily was a museum studies student in Indianapolis, where we were, went on to work for the Getty in LA and LACMA, also in LA, and now teaches about digital strategy and technology, and is still a great friend. Sylvia Filippini Fantoni was someone I met at a conference, like just like this. We struck up a friendship. She's Italian from Bergamo, outside of Milan. She studied museum studies at the Sorbonne in Paris. She worked at the Louvre and at the British Museum, and she worked for me from Venice for a little while before she moved to Indianapolis. Now she leads a team, a visitor experience team at Indianapolis, who are studying the ways that people experience the museum. She speaks something like 27 million languages, and is brilliant. This was more of that same team. We built a software team there, and they became dear friends. Two guys in particular, from the left, with a great big bushy beard, was Chris Arnold. Chris was a smoker, a rocker, a hacker, and probably the most creative person I've ever known. Ed, you've already met. Ed was a master's in computer science and a martial arts student. And when I first hired them, they didn't like each other very much. Ed would run a HEPA filter at his desk because Chris sat across from him chain smoking, or would chain smoke in the driveway and come back in. So they didn't really like it. Ed was very straight-laced. Chris was the opposite of straight-laced. But over time, they learned from each other, and they learned from each other's difference more than anything else. I specifically purposed to put their desks right next to each other. We had a very long office. I could have put them on either end of the office, but they had what the other one needed, right? Chris was the most inventive person you would ever met. He was more fast and facile with the computer than anyone I'd ever seen. Ed was crystalline and perfect and straight line and expert and clear, and so the two really played off of each other. What was very sad is that shortly after I left Indianapolis, Ed Bakta took his own life. He was suffering with depression that was unknown to us as family members who were very, really close to him. And you know, I don't think he knew or appreciated how much we cared for him. And today still, this is really dorky, but today still, if you go to the IMA website, you'll see this image in the code. So some of you know how to look at the code of websites. This image is embedded at the bottom of the website. It's a picture of Ed, and Chris embedded that image there back in 2013. It's still there today. I'm really proud of them for keeping it around. It's migrated through now three different versions of the website, but it's a memorial from Chris to Ed about how much he meant to him. So those teams keep going, right? In Dallas, when I moved there, we began a huge digitization project. And if any of you are working on photographing your collection or handling collections, it's a monumental task. And so we had a team of 12 that needed to work like this finely oiled machine. And as I was pulling this together, I remembered this graph that we made, right? It looks like one of those ecosystem graphs where you say how everyone's supposed to work and interact with each other. And that's exactly how this team worked together. It took what we called a cast of thousands. This is just some of what was our web team here from Brooke in the upper left. Brooke came from the UK, ran channel marketing for British Telecom. And on the far right, Carlos is a Colombian who immigrated to Australia, living in Sydney, working for us in Dallas. So it's sort of these global connections that happen across the field. Our educators at the bottom would work across the community with people who felt like they had no access or reason to be in an art museum. One of our favorite connections with the education department was their tour for visually impaired people and children. This was a tour of some of those children who the team made special accommodation for so that they could come in and experience what art was like for them. Our visitor services team were probably some of the most miraculous people that I've had the privilege to know. Gannett in the upper corner was one of three women who were gallery attendants for us, who when I started in Dallas, came to me and shared with me the ways in which they were really being mistreated in the galleries, right? Before they would go, they were asked to empty their pockets so that we could check and make sure they didn't have their cell phones on them because we were worried that they might chat on Facebook in the gallery, right? And I said to our staff, well, if I'm going to stand in the gallery, are you worried that I'm going to chat on my phone? And there were a whole host of other reasons, but it became a touch point for me about what it meant to treat our staff with respect in a way that treated them in the same professional dignity that I would want to be treated, and deputize them as ambassadors to this community. On the bottom, in the middle, is the tallest guy, is Andre Anthony. Andre is a permanent fixture at the entrance of the DMA, and he is the person that makes you feel welcome when you showed up. And if the DMA did not have Andre on staff, the visitors in the community would be much poorer for it. Ashabar is on the right-hand side. Ashabar became a U.S. citizen while I was there, and we were privileged to host the nationalization ceremony at the museum for these new citizens to think of themselves as Americans in the context of the museum. We had some fun, too. It was Texas, so you gotta do beer parties in Texas. So my boss and I, Max, became licensed bartenders in the state of Texas so that we could serve our team Texas beer at least once a year in the garden, and we would have a good old time. Maybe that's a Texas thing, but I think all of you have your own rituals as well. So what are those rituals that bond your team together? As I've moved to AAM, I'm beginning to make new friends and new team members and gathering more folks here, whether it's Megan in the pink jacket on the bottom, who used to work at a fruit roll-up factory in Vietnam, or Kathy, who's been the director of four or five museums and now helps us figure out our strategy for engaging with trustees, or Beth Merritt, who's the founding director of the Center for Future of Museums, and Della, who's our adopted office dog. Without Della, we'd be lost. So let's, thank you for indulging me of a little bit of a family notebook, but if we want museums to change the world, we have to pay attention to what we're doing to change our own circumstance. So a couple of points here. If museums expect the public to visit and learn, then we must become learners too. So what are you doing in your own organization that would help you learn about your operations? Maybe some of you have heard about a pilot called John Boyd. He was a fighter pilot in the Korean War, and in terms of being a fighter pilot, he wasn't very successful. He was only ever in 2 dogfights, never succeeded in shooting anyone down, but he is probably known as one of the most influential military strategists and was in charge of the strategy for most of our military's current endeavors, for better or for worse. But he pioneered what was called the OODA loop, right, in which he observed that the pilot who could go through this loop the fastest was most often the victor or the most successful. So you would observe your surroundings, orient yourself to which way the ground was, right, which way's up, decide on what the best course of action was, and then take that course of action. And then you repeat the loop all over again. You've taken the action. Now observe again, orient to where ground is, decide on what to do next, and act. And so his whole idea is that the person who can execute this loop the fastest will be the most successful. So what does that mean for your museum, right? Sometimes our planning cycles in museums are terribly long, right? I've been a part of exhibition planning that was 10 years in the making. Most exhibitions are 4-year endeavors. Most publications take at least a year. Most websites take at least 6 months to build. What are you doing that you can break your work down into a weekly bite-sized chunk and take a look at it, right? So in Dallas, we really believed this, and we believed that if we could break it into bite-sized chunks, then that regular measurement could help us get better at our jobs. And we really cared about our outreach to the community. So we did a few different things. We dropped the admission price. We removed it altogether. We found out that it was a barrier to our broadest community feeling like they were a part of the museum. So we went from a $10 admission to free. And we said, well, the first experience you have when you walk through the door is somebody asks you, are you a member? And if you're somebody from the community that thinks of the museum as a country club already, then that first question is just reinforcing that exact same conception. So we established a program called DMA Friends. It was a free membership program, so that rather than being asked, are you a member when you arrive at the museum, you were asked, would you like to be a friend of the museum? And you could either say yes or no. Underneath the hood, it was a digital CRM, like many of you are working with, that helped us understand what people did after they entered the door. So it's not enough just to count attendance, because somebody can visit you and have a terrible time and never come back. But if they come, they have a great experience, and they return, chances are you have a better chance of actually impacting them and their community. So we designed DMA Friends as an iPad kiosk platform, where you would use it like a menu at a restaurant to look at all of the experiences that were happening in the museum that day. And if you decided that you wanted to sign up, you could text us and let us know what you were doing. And as you texted us, we would say thanks by awarding you a certain number of points. So maybe if you visit the American Gallery, you'd get 100 points. And if you participated in one of our education spaces, you might get 1,000 points. Or if you write us a comment, right? We put a lot of points behind people who would actually write us a substantive comment. And by doing that, we created a bit of an experience economy, right? But it also gave us the opportunity to measure what was working and what wasn't working about the visitor experience in the museum. We used that to look at the zip codes from around Dallas and where our participation was coming from. Our goal was to be a perfect mirror of the community, right? So that would mean as many old people were in Dallas, that's the percentage we would have in the museum. As many African people were in Dallas, that's as many who would be in the museum. So we decided a good way to go after this was by looking at our balance by neighborhood, right? And so this is a map by neighborhood of participation with friends. And if we were getting the right or in balance participation, the squiggly shape is in white. We got more than in balance, it was in green, and less than in balance, it was in red. So those of you that know Dallas a little bit, off to the west here is Fort Worth. And if you really wanted to go to a museum in Fort Worth, there are great places for you to go. You don't need to drive into downtown. You have the Kimball, the Modern, the Amon Carter, just to mention the art museums. In our museum, the Dallas Museum of Art, is very in the very center of the map by the darkest green sections. No surprise, if you're in the neighborhood that's right next door to the museum, you're going to go there quite often. But you'll see that that extends quite far north, and we were confused by this shape in the upper left-hand corner. We didn't really know what's going on out there. It turns out that's the University of North Texas at Denton, with a very strong fine arts degree program. So all those students were trekking down the freeway on the weekends to come see us. And this community right in here was the very sort of art-friendly, hip neighborhood. But it was right next door to some communities that you'll notice in red. These are our communities, our neighborhoods, where historically we've had low, they are by and large a lower socioeconomic stratum, but a very high percentage of home ownership. They live in Dallas forever. They're true Dallasites. They are within a 10-minute drive of the museum, but more than an hour and 15 minutes on public transportation. They are most likely to not speak English at home, and the museum had very poor Spanish language content for the public. So this was a map, or a thermometer, finally, that could help us understand when we would try out a new program or a new way of outreach. We could actually see in real time, was that making a difference? So rather than having to wait for the end of the year and our annual visitor survey, we could look every week to see, okay, that outreach we tried last week, did it seem to work? If it did, let's do it again. Did it work again? And so that was a very systematic way where we could start to measure our impact on the community. I'm going to skip over our story about Bobby for a little bit here, because I think it's more important to talk about this team. This was our front of house team, and it turns out they were the ones who were most responsible for encouraging the public to engage with DMA Friends. And so I'm going to show you some graphics that they had up on the computer right at the front desk. The public didn't see it, but they were watching it. So this is a look at the number of new friends joining the program during the first probably year of time that we ran it. We have about 115,000 members of the Friends program right now. And you can see we launched, and you had your typical bump at the very beginning, and then it fell off, right? But what you'll notice right there, right, during the summer, this visitor services team, this front of house team, began experimenting with how they described the program to the public and how they positioned themselves near the door, how they paired up with one English speaker and one Spanish speaker, one person who knew the program well, one person who didn't know the program well. And you can see week over week, they started to hone in on their approach. And that's all the little black lines there are the 12-week average. So you can see over that course of time, they started to really narrow it in. And then they got pretty good, and it stayed flat. Towards the winter, they began experimenting a little bit more. And so if I'd extended this graph out more, you'd see that bump up and down a little bit and then increase and level off. So they were using this data in real time, sometimes daily, to judge how they were doing. And it was their Fitbit, right? It was their Fitbit for the museum, where they were counting their steps, in this case, counting how many people felt like they would join us as a friend. In a similar way, we used rewards as an incentive to get people to participate. So if you earned 1,000 points with the museum, you could trade that in on real stuff, right? Free parking to come back, an exhibition ticket, the occasion to go into art storage with one of our curators. And so in the winter of 2013, we were having an exhibition that wasn't proving to be too successful, right? And so we decided to partner with our marketing department and see if we could pump that up using some of what we were doing in Friends. So we went into our database, we looked, well, who are the friends that have a whole bunch of points? Let's send a special message to them and say, if you come back, you can use your points to come to this exhibition for free. So you can see the blue stripes in here are the number of folks who have claimed this exhibition reward. And that first week in December was when we sent the message out. And it proved to us that we actually can get a call and response with this audience, that we can move them in the right direction, or what we're interested in. So we started to get into thinking more and more about how do we create patterns of behavior of our first-time visitors that look like the behaviors of people that come back a dozen times, right? So just on, this is a very, my boss called this the most inscrutable graph in the world. But it's looking on the top are people who don't repeat their visits and the average number and kind of things that they do, right? So they came to the museum once, they became a friend, they did some stuff, and they never came back. Versus people on the bottom who came, became a friend, participated. So many of those are coming back a dozen or more times. Some are up to 200 times inside of a year. So what does that look like? What are people actually doing? And how do we coax a brand new visitor into a pattern of behavior that looks like that? So that's what we were working on. Still a work in progress. So moving forward a little bit, another point, if museums want to be a place of caring and dialogue, then we have to care and talk about hard issues right now. And it's all too easy to avoid that in conversation. And I'm guilty of that as well. I've shied away from those hard questions and conversations, and I think to my detriment. Many of you know the American Alliance of Museums as the 100-year-old organization that sets policy and standards for the museum field. Part of my job is to move us into a position that thinks more broadly about what are the important issues for the field. One of those in our strategic plan is looking at how museums can become more diverse, more equitable, more accessible to the public, and more inclusive of all people. So this year in St. Louis, this spring, the theme of our annual meeting will be that, diversity, equity, accessibility, and inclusion. And this is a conversation that extends on one that we've had the two prior years, which is looking about the social impact of museums. Now, I will tell you that AAM has not always been on the right position on this issue, and it's been intimidating, right, to stand up. I'm a white man, wealthy, I've had a great job, I have had all the privilege that comes with that, and I may be the least qualified person in the room to talk about this, but I think we need to talk about it. I need to learn from all of you. I need to learn from folks in the field who are working in these areas. And unless AAM uses its position to host those conversations, I don't think the field has the platform or the occasion to move forward. So this is the platform. This is an occasion. It will happen across lots of different times. St. Louis is a remarkable city that is working in these areas right now, has been for the last decade. I hope that we learn a lot from them about how to do that, but I hope more so that each of you will take those conversations back to your organization and learn from each other about how the museum can be more diverse and more equitable, more welcoming, and more accessible. If we want all people to feel welcomed in the museum, then we need to become places that welcome our staff effectively first. So, I told you the story about Chris earlier in Indianapolis, the chain smoker, punk rocker, fastest coder in the West. Chris worked with me in Indianapolis. Shortly after I left, Chris asked if he could come and work with me in Dallas. So this is a picture of Chris at our offices at the Dallas Museum of Art. And what became clear a few months after he arrives that Chris was a person in transition to Kristen. So my friend Chris became my friend Chrissy, and she began a transition that included her family, taking care of her kids, her spouse, maintaining an active profession. And what happened, I'm going to go back and forth. Chris was often a dark personality and often sad. Chrissy was bright and vibrant. Chris confided in me that he didn't feel the confidence in being able to make that change or transition in Indianapolis. Wouldn't have struck me that Dallas was a much better place to do that. but it turned out that it was. And so Chrissy found a supportive community in and around the museum. When I left Dallas for DC, Chrissy left and worked for SF MoMA in San Francisco and pursued both her music and her career in museums, but shortly afterwards, Chrissy took her own life. She found that even in a city like San Francisco, it was difficult to find her place and to settle in. She was often dismayed about the current political conversation and you know, what it meant for who she was and who she would be and who her friends were. This is Chrissy's a very different person than I am. I had very little experience with transgendered people before I knew Chrissy, but I loved her and she was my friend. Thought it was really poignant that AAM's LGBTQ Alliance released their welcoming guidelines the day after Chrissy committed suicide. And I feel like this is a really important document that does a good job of articulating the ways that museums can create an environment that's welcoming to all kinds of people. Many of us in the room are different than each other. That's what makes this room beautiful. That's what makes our museums beautiful. This is a great document for you as a reference. It's unfortunately, I feel like it's a little buried. I've got a link here. I'll post these slides on our website. But if you just search for the LGBTQ welcoming guidelines, you'll find it. I would encourage you to use this when you're thinking about ways to engage your whole staff, right? And think about what that really means. We're going to be working to expand this to areas and issues outside of LGBTQ and to bring that conversation back to the forefront as often as we can. So if we want museums to change the world, if we want your organization to change the world, then we have to start by changing museums and our organization first. So what about AAM? What are we doing? I arrived, I show up, again, we're 100 years old. Many of your organizations are 100 years old. I have felt at times that AAM has been stuck in the mud. I feel right now that we're not stuck in the mud. So what are we doing to change our internal culture and community first? I felt that when I arrived, we had a very formal organization, and AAM has been great at sharing about policy and advocating for the field and connecting with lawmakers and stating what the rules are. We've been very bad at experimentation, and it's hard to put a wishy-washy, hey, let's try this digital presence on right next to the space where we're advocating for congressional funding for culture and right next to each other. It's hard to say what the standard for the field should be when we're exploring what the standards for the field might be. And so how do you, as an audience, tell the difference? So we needed some space to experiment, and we needed to create some real estate. Luckily, in digital, that's so much easier than it ever has been. And think about that for your organization. Many of you are august institutions, right, that trade on your brand as an authority for culture. To get some wild-haired mad scientist innovation experimentation vibe going on there may be some dissonance, some out of balance, out of whack with that brand or that image. You can create some elbow room, some space. So our space is called Alliance Labs. It formed labs in Indianapolis, that lab sitting around the table with Chrissy and Ed. That was our lab in Indianapolis. This lab is a little different. It's not about technology. And we say that our tagline is about experimenting together. It's figuring it out. It's just figuring it out. We're sitting in the room here, we're figuring it out. We might tackle diversity, we might tackle what it means to create content. We have a goal on global thinking. What should the American Alliance of Museums do in a global environment of culture? And so we're pulling together the team. Megan, again, Fruit Roll-Up Factory Megan, and Allie work to lead our global efforts. And they're telling stories about the work we've already been doing. I didn't know that AAM had done global cultural development work with the State Department for 10 years. We've connected museums in the US with developing third country cultural organizations, person to person. And so they're going back and they're telling those stories. They told about a connection between MIA, the art museum in Minneapolis, with a girls' school in Nairobi, Kenya, and about a girl named Sanaji who grew up in the Mukuru slums in Kenya, who dreamed of being able to fly one day because she saw the planes going overhead. And she was able to come and visit Minneapolis and meet the girls from Minneapolis. And they worked together on projects that would address a shortage of water in the world. So who would have thought that an art museum in Indianapolis or in Minneapolis would be working on solving the world's water crisis between girls in Minneapolis and Kenya? That's a great story. We need to tell that story. Megan and Allie are doing it. Greg and Cecilia have worked for AAM for, you know, over a decade. Many of you may know Greg Stevens from our webinars, right? He's the webinar maestro. He hosts them all. He's super talented, and they know where all the content is buried. They have the complete list. So I challenged them, and they both come with a bit of a theater background. Greg, in particular, was also a teacher. So you can see his bulletin board skills coming into focus here. But this is sort of a brainstorming board where they're planning how content should work and how we can funnel it out to you guys. We minted our first organizational constitution. Now, I'm not sure how many of you have an organizational constitution, but I would encourage you to start that discussion and dialogue. What does it mean to work and collaborate inside your museum? What are the things that you value? So these are the ones that we have in our constitution. We will celebrate our passion and creativity for each other in the field. We will deliver wow service to each other in the field. We're going to learn and we're going to grow together and we're going to respect each other. Now, inside of all of that, we sort of unrolled what each one of those were. So in red, you'll see how we phrased them. And these are in the first person, that to celebrate passion and creativity, I will seek higher levels of involvement in the work I find interesting. I will share my passions with others and seek out ways for my talents to be utilized. And I will confess to you that this was not the most popular initiative we've ever done with the staff. I would say it's a 50-50 mix, and it's still evolving, right? A number of staff feel like, I'm an adult, I don't need to be told how to act in the workplace. This is remedial, right? But if we don't write it down, if we don't prioritize it, we don't take action on it, then we can't tell that it's going to happen, we can't continue to work on it. So our approach is that we develop this with the staff, and we're implementing it in the executive team first. So our executive team are going through a series of 360 reviews from the rest of the staff that rate us on our performance to these organizational culture and attributes. We've been through one of those. Any of you that have done 360s know they're bruising. But we got to start, and the executive team has to lead it out. So that's something we're trying to do. We're also working on blind hiring practices, and we're recognizing that each of us as a hiring manager have unknown biases in the way that we would review a resume, talk to you on the phone, see you in person, that those unknown biases are not even conscious much of the time, but they affect the way that we hire and staff our organizations. So you can read about this on Beth's Future of Museums blog. And Nicole Ivey has been a great fellow for us who's studying the future of work. And Nicole will be hosting more seminars and symposia around this issue and how museums can better diversify our staffs and our boardrooms. So this is a little bit like The Voice, right? Where all the judges have their backs to the stage and they're only hitting their buzzer based on what they're hearing coming through the speakers, right? So we're trying to set up strategies and practices to address this in our hiring as well. We're specifically asking candidates to not give us their email and social media handles when they apply, to talk about their qualifications. We're trying challenge-based hiring, where we'll ask for an essay that addresses a particular question, and we'll review that before we review resumes. We're disciplining and restricting ourselves from checking out, you know, people in the way that we normally would, right? And we're making sure that every applicant has an even playing field. So we're actually preferring phone conferences over video conferences in the early stages. And we're trying to do this to guard ourselves against these implicit biases. It's an interesting experiment, and we'll be looking for museums to partner with who might want to trial these kinds of practices in their own HR areas. So if that's you, you can get in touch with me after the fact and I'll connect you with Beth. So we are certainly not there, right? We're taking our licks, we're getting knocked down, we're a little off balance. We are a little like the Tacoma Narrows Bridge at times, but we're aware of it, we're working on it. And the thing I've been most proud about at AAM is that we're staying the course, right? We're taking the critique when it's warranted, and we're wrapping that into our practice, and we're trying to improve and get better. So we're trying to change that from the inside out, hoping that doing that and leading by example will encourage and inspire you to do the same things and to lead by example. One final bit. This is a picture of our team in Indianapolis, and maybe what was my favorite artwork that we commissioned during the time there. On the left in the white and khaki is Lisa Fryman, who's now the director of the Institute for Contemporary Art at Virginia Commonwealth University. And this is a team building exercise that was a part of the, it was a performance art leading up to this commission called Align. So it was suspended in our Art and Nature Park. It was by an artist duo called Type A, who often creates works of art about collaboration and competition. And I thought it especially apt for this meeting. So these are two, maybe 40 foot in diameter, stainless steel rings that are suspended from trees. They're parallel to each other, but offset a little bit. They represent the ways in which we collaborate and overlap our efforts with each other, right? We're of the same, we're sort of working in parallel with each other, but we're disconnected and we're offset, right? So you might notice on the ground the shadow of these two rings. And what you'll notice in this picture is there's only one shadow. And the position of the rings was specifically chosen for this site, that those shadows would align on the equinox. So two times each year. So only two times a year are the shadows in alignment. But it's a powerful statement about what it means to work and to align our efforts together. And it always makes me think, paired with that team building exercise, about what I can do to be in alignment and in sync, right, with my colleagues and my team. But I hope it will inspire you too. Thank you for listening so kindly. I was laying in bed last night a little bit nervous, thinking, oh man, I'm going to share about my friends who died for a morning coffee. But I decided, you know what, Chrissy and Ed would be honored by the fact that their example would possibly help museums and your organizations change the world, because that's what they were in it for too. It was strange, and any of you who have lost people who were close to you will identify with this. When they were gone, so many people came out of the woodwork who loved and cared about them. And it's highly likely that the two of them, neither of them were aware of those people. And so in closing, I would just encourage you that perhaps the best way that you can cultivate collaboration with your team is that when you have that good thought that fleets through your mind about, wow, that person is awesome, or what would we do without so-and-so, would you please go and tell them, and tell them now, today, because you don't know when you might lose them, or you don't know, even disconnected for a variety of reasons. But I think, and I've put that into practice myself, that if I'd had the opportunity in hindsight to tell Chrissy and Ed how much of a difference they were making, that would have meant a lot to them and would have meant a lot to me. So thanks so much for your time this morning. I really appreciate it, and I hope you'll have a great afternoon together. Thanks.